think we are ready to call the next case. I see both counsel here. People versus Manning. This is a mini oral argument on the application. Ms. Rice, you have 15 minutes and you can try and reserve some of that for rebuttal.
Thank you, Chief Justice. Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. My name is Amanda Rice and I represent the appellant, Robin Manning. I'll try my best to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. Robin Manning was just 3 months past his 18th birthday when he accompanied a friend to a teenage fight in which one boy was shot and killed. Mr. Manning did not fire that shot, but he was convicted of murder and received a mandatory sentence of life without the possibility of parole. Mr. Manning is now 54 years old. In the decades he has spent in prison, there has been a sea change, both in juvenile brain science and as a result in the law applicable to the sentencing of juveniles. In particular, in 2012, the Supreme Court held in Miller that mandatory life without parole sentences for juveniles are unconstitutional. That ruling was based on the distinctive attributes of youth that make them less capable than adults for their culpable than adults for their wrongdoing and more capable than adults of change. In particular, children are prone to recklessness. They are vulnerable to outside influences, and their character traits are not yet fixed. Those considerations apply equally to defendants like Mr. Manning, who were 18 years old at the time of their offense. In fact, the key passage from Miller, which discusses peer pressure and children's ability to evaluate plea bargains, could have been written for this case. But Miller had not been decided when Mr. Manning was sentenced or when he filed his original motion for relief. That is why his successive motion is authorized by the Michigan rules. As this court recognized in People versus Swain, 502G is merely a procedural threshold. And here, because Mr. Manning's claim is based on the retroactive change of law in Miller, that threshold is satisfied. The lower courts were wrong to treat that provision as requiring a defendant to show an entitlement to relief on the merits at the filing stage. I can continue, but if the court has questions at this juncture, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Let's take a break and go through and see who has questions, and then we can come back to you. Justice Bernstein.
No questions.
Justice Clement.
Thank you. Just one question, and I know you haven't gotten to this yet. You've briefed it very well. Tell me where we draw the line. You're asking us to extend Miller to 18-year-olds, but the data and the science keeps changing over the years. Why shouldn't we extend this to 19-year-olds or 22-year-olds? Or where do we draw that line, and what would be the basis for it?
Yeah, so it's a good question, Your Honor. And to resolve this case, the court need only hold that mandatory life without parole sentences are unconstitutional for 18-year-olds. I think the differences that Miller itself relied on are clearest with respect to 18-year-olds, and an incremental approach is consistent with the general trajectory of this area of law. But to answer your question directly, I think you're right to suggest, and the Supreme Court itself said this in Roper, that line drawing, while always difficult, is perhaps particularly so in this context. But I guess I'd say that the fact that there is no perfect line isn't a good reason not to try to draw a better one. And so if the court is inclined to rule more broadly, I think there's a scientific consensus that the juvenile brain doesn't fully develop until age 25. And there's a deepening social consensus and sort of a legislative one around the age of 21 as a workable line in many different contexts.
Thank you.
Justice Kavanaugh?
No questions.
Justice Markman?
I have no questions, thank you.
Justice Zara?
No questions, thank you.
Justice Viviano?
No questions, thank you.
I have one, Ms. Rice. And it's related, I think, to Justice Clement's question. To the extent the science is settled for 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds and maybe 20-year-olds, in this particular litigation, we have it in briefing, in appellate briefing, but there was no, the trial court never held a hearing on that, and if I were Ms. Williams, I might want to, or whoever would represent Ms. Williams' office in the trial court, I might want to present expert testimony of my own. So it would be unusual for us in, in an appellate case to not have fact finding on that kind of issue. What do I do about that?
It's a good question, Your Honor. I think I'd say first that Mr. Manning had no opportunity to even try to present that kind of expert testimony here because his motion was rejected at the procedural threshold stage. So one way to resolve this case would be to reverse on that ground and remand for the lower courts to consider the merits and including expert testimony if that's helpful to the resolution here. I do think, though, that the scientific literature is well briefed, both in the briefs here, in the secondary literature. So I do think there's enough here for you to reach the merits yourself, but a remand for the lower courts to do that in the first instant would also be a perfectly appropriate resolution.
Okay, you may continue.
Sure. So I'll say a bit about the procedural issue first, because that's the only issue that the lower courts actually addressed here. I'd start by saying that 502G is a threshold procedural bar, and it requires only that the successive motion be based on a retroactive change in law, not that the defendant establish an automatic entitlement to relief. And I think that's clear for a number of reasons. And the first is the plain meaning of the phrase based on. I cite some dictionary definitions in our brief, but I'm not actually sure you need those here. The ordinary meaning of that word just means to be derived from or built upon. I'd say that's also consistent with the provision structure, which distinguishes between the threshold filing inquiry in 502 and then the merits inquiry, which comes later. It's also consistent with 502G's purpose, which is to create a simple pre-screening mechanism that encourages defendants to raise pre-existing claims in their initial appeal, but doesn't punish them when new claims come about later on, either through a retroactive change in law as here, or as you addressed in People versus Swain on the new evidence provision. And on Swain, I do think that based on can't mean two different things within the same sentence here. And I'm not sure how the government would square their sort of substantive reading of based on here with the court's holding in that case. So I think the answer to the first question on which the court ordered supplemental briefing is pretty simple here. There's no requirement to entitlement to relief at the filing stage. So at the very least, the court should reverse and remand for consideration of the merits. On the merits, I guess just a couple of points. I think Miller relied on the three primary characteristics of juveniles, the sort of impulsivity and recklessness, the vulnerability to outside influences, including family, and the capacity for change and reform over time. And I think there's a clear scientific consensus that those considerations apply to 18-year-olds like Mr. Manning, just as they do to younger adolescents. And there's a social consensus too. I'll give you just a couple of examples. As I'm sure you know, individuals under 21 can't buy alcohol or since 2019, even tobacco anywhere in the country. Here in Michigan, the Holmes Youthful Trainee Act provides special protections for young defendants up to the age of 21, even without prosecutorial consent. In all states, including Michigan, juvenile courts can exercise jurisdiction over 18-year-olds. In most states, also including Michigan, 18-year-olds are eligible for foster care services and a free public education. Children under 21 generally aren't allowed to gamble, and they have restricted access to firearms. I could continue, but I'd suggest that you take a look at the great discussion of these other laws in the Juvenile Law Center and ACLU's amicus brief from page 12, and also in the criminal defense attorney's brief from page 29. If the court has further questions at this point, I'd be happy to answer them, or else I'll reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Are there additional questions at this point? You may reserve. Ms. Williams.
Thank you, Madam Chief Justice, and may it please the court. My name is Heidi Williams, and I represent the appellee, the people of the state of Michigan, in this matter. This case presents what are undoubtedly important constitutional questions under the Eighth Amendment of the United States Constitution and Article 1, Section 16 of our own state constitution. The United States Supreme Court and this court have wrestled with now for decades the question whether and the extent to which the concept of proportionality plays a role in sentencing review. However, before this court can reach the important constitutional questions raised by the case, it has to deal with the fact that the case comes before the court on collateral review following the denial of defendant's successive motion for relief from judgment. Accordingly, defendant has to satisfy the lofty procedural threshold of MCR 6.502G2 before the court can reach the merits of his constitutional claims. This court should deny leave to appeal or alternatively affirm the decision of the Court of Appeals for two reasons. First, defendant's successive motion is procedurally barred under MCR 6.502G2 because it is not based on a retroactive change in law. And second, even assuming defendant's motion satisfies the procedural threshold, he is not entitled to relief on the merits because he has not demonstrated that he satisfies the diligence requirements of MCR 6508D, nor has he shown that his sentence is unconstitutional under either the Eighth Amendment or Article 1, Section 16. Just briefly before I invite any questions from the court, I wanted to mention the Michigan Court of Appeals issued a published opinion on Friday in People versus Stovall. It's docket number 342440. And in Stovall, the court addressed a successive motion for relief from judgment that was raised by a juvenile offender, but who had been sentenced to life with the possibility of parole. And the court held in a published opinion that that defendant satisfied the procedural threshold of MCR 6502. At the time I was briefing, you know, I kind of, in my own opinion, thinking about these issues was contemplating, you know, what's the need for this court to, say, issue an opinion versus deny leave to appeal on the procedural question. And at the time I wrote my brief, I don't believe there was any published authority on point. The defendant noted in their brief, and I also addressed two unpublished opinions from the Court of Appeals, People versus Miller and People versus Johnson. But now that we have a published opinion on the books, you know, that is at least, I wanted to bring it to the court's attention because that may be a factor in deciding, you know, if you agree with my analysis versus the defendant's analysis, that may be a pressing point to suggest that an opinion is warranted, at least on the procedural question. With that, I'm happy to proceed through the arguments or to invite any questions from the court.
Why don't we see if folks have questions first and then you can proceed. Justice Bernstein?
No questions.
Justice Clement?
No questions right now. Thank you.
Justice Kavanaugh?
No questions for me.
Justice Markman?
No questions. Thank you.
Justice Zari?
No questions. Thanks.
Justice Viviano?
No questions. Thank you.
Why don't you proceed, that people may interrupt you as you go on?
Of course. So if I addressing the procedural issue first, I think this is actually a really interesting issue and one that I found kind of complicated. You know, determining what the law is from a judicial opinion seems like something that would be one of the most basic skills a lawyer has to master. But particularly when we're talking about opinions in modern day society, where oftentimes judicial opinions read more like law review articles than simply resolutions of the cases immediately before them, I think we get into some interesting questions of, well, you know, how do we deal with a lot of these path to judgment statements, or when the courts are opining on principles that are far more broad than the specific circumstances of the case that come before them. And the position of the people on this point is that in Miller, the court announced a holding that applied specifically to persons under the age of 18. And to say that the law from Miller went much beyond that, as the defendant alleges, they say, well, we can cite certain propositions of reason that the court enunciated along its path to reaching its judgment and say, well, that's part of the law of Miller and we can rely upon that moving forward. I think that creates some problems because those propositions, at least in my opinion, are not precedentially binding. And I think a concern about the court adopting the defendant's rationale in this case, and obviously I don't want to make the argument that just, you know, anyone can make a challenge, but I mean, if we say what are the broadest possible principles articulated in Miller, and perhaps that principle is, well, a sentence must be proportionate. So what would then, if the fact is that a defendant can cite any reasoning proposition from Miller and say, well, I'm citing the rationale from Miller and I think it should apply to a new class of defendants that are not encompassed by the court's articulated holding, then what's to prevent someone who was sentenced to something, you know, not life without the possibility of parole, or someone who is much older than the defendants in Miller, and even much older than the defendant in this case, and saying, well, I'd like to challenge the proportionality of my sentence for XYZ reason. Miller said a sentence has to be proportional, so I'm basing my successive motion on Miller. Miller involved a retroactive change in law, and I've passed the procedural threshold. I mean, at some point, I think there comes the question of why have MCR 6502 at all? So again, those are just some of the concerns I would raise regarding procedural question. Then even assuming that the rationale for Miller does carry the force and effect of law, some of the more generalized principles that defendant's motion is based on, again, weren't new to Miller. These were principles that were articulated in Roper and in Graham versus Florida, and before that in Thompson versus Oklahoma. So if those are the law upon which defendant relies, it's, in my opinion, questionable why those same kinds of arguments couldn't have been raised in an earlier successive motion for relief from judgment. If the court doesn't have any questions on the procedural issue, I'll just touch briefly on the merits issues of the Eighth Amendment claim first. So in Miller, the United States Supreme Court drew a very hard line at the age of 18, you know, for better or worse. And if we hearken back all the way to Roper back in 2005, the United States Supreme Court, in announcing this bright line age of 18, announced and admitted that whenever you draw a bright line like this, it's going to be in some ways inherently over and under inclusive. That's the reality of this kind of line drawing. And Justice Clement, you know, the questions you raised are good ones. And I think they're difficult questions to answer for the defendant, particularly because if the court is going to expand the line, you know, how far does it go and what principles do you have to rely upon in drawing a new line? You know, at this juncture, the United States Supreme Court has drawn the line at 18. And, you know, whatever the merits of moving away, and because I think we are in general moving away from these kind of determinate sentencing schemes where things are mandatory, but whatever the merits of that as applied to adult offenders like defendant, in my opinion, the United States Supreme Court precedent doesn't justify moving that line any further at this point in time. And then turning to the state constitutional issue, again, my argument, in my briefing on appeal, I mimicked a lot of the arguments that this court addressed, I think, in People versus Karp, where it addressed the Lorenz and Bullock proportionality test and essentially said that a mandatory sentence of life without the possibility of parole imposed on a juvenile offender after that individual had received a Miller hearing could not be categorically barred, looking through the various factors. So, yes, this is the most, life without the possibility of parole is the most severe sentence that can be imposed in the state of Michigan. But likewise, the offense of which defendant stands convicted, first degree murder, is one, if not the most serious offense in the state. In addition, there are other non-homicide offenses in Michigan that also carry a penalty for life without the possibility of parole when committed by an adult offender. And although, you know, defendant points out that there are less than half of the states currently imposing mandatory life without the possibility of parole sentences, by the information they provided in their appendix, there are at least 19 states in the federal government that still do so. And based on the case law we have, you know, in People versus Benton, which was a published Michigan Court of Appeals opinion, only 18 states impose the same sentence as Michigan. And this court denied leave to appeal, and the Court of Appeals concluded that that amount of states having the same sentence suggested that the sentence was in fact constitutional. And in Lorenzen and Bullock, there were only respectively one other state or no other states that imposed sentences as harsh as Michigan did. And those then, this court in Lorenzen and Bullock said, you know, that supported that the sentences were unconstitutional. So I think even applying this court's existing jurisprudence on proportionality review in Lorenzen and Bullock the sentence here is constitutional. Alternatively, and I would direct this court's attention to Justice Dorothy Comstock Riley's dissenting opinion in Bullock and Tim Boffman's amicus brief in this case to suggest the reasons why perhaps Bullock and Lorenzen were incorrectly decided, if, you know, even assuming defendant could satisfy the inquiry under those two cases. Does the court have any additional questions on the merits?
Mrs. Kavanaugh, looks like she does.
I just have a question. And because I think, you know, obviously you've given a lot of thoughtful consideration to this. And I think that, you know, your position that it doesn't support the considerations in Miller don't support moving that line at this time. Do you have thoughts of what would support moving the line at a particular time? What is it that would inform us, either, you know, us as the Michigan Supreme Court under our constitution, or perhaps other courts across the state, what would support moving that line?
Justice Kavanaugh, I think that's a great question and one that is extremely difficult to answer because I think this is one of the primary complaints and criticisms of proportionality review in general, right? So as soon as proportionality review is on the table in some way, shape, or form, it is asking courts to make policy decisions, at least that's a criticism of it, policy decision based on the court's understanding of the evolving standards of decency in society. So I don't think I have a really excellent answer of when does that line change. I don't think, you know, I think it's questionable whether or not there was a really great answer when the court drew the line at 18 to begin with in Roper and Graham and then in Miller. You know, so we see that the United States Supreme Court has relied on social psychological data. You know, the fact that in certain states, maybe the line for, you know, say if all voting ages were increased to 21 and you couldn't be drafted until you were 21. And, you know, there's a whole list of these social factors that we try to parse out and say, well, when do we consider someone an adult and why? I just don't think I have a really excellent answer to you because I think that it's really just an invitation at that point in time for drawing kind of an arbitrary line. So I don't know if that's a great answer to your question.
No, I appreciate it. I guess it was sort of unfair. I don't know that there really is an answer to it, but I think that is sort of at the heart of what we have to decide, right? What right. Everybody has to. Thank you, I appreciate it.
Are there additional questions from Ms. Williams? Okay, thank you, Ms. Williams.
Thank you. Just briefly, Justice Kavanaugh, you know, a thought I had, and again, this is one of these things that I think, especially as this court is considering our own state constitution and figuring out a lineup, I would just direct your attention to Dorothy Comstock Riley's dissent in Bullock, where she wrote, you know, evolving standards of decency as to the appropriate proportionate sentence for a crime are to be measured. Are to be the measure of the constitutionality of a legislatively set penalty. How is such an inquiry to be carried out? What enables a court to overrule society's expression of the standard of decency communicated through statute, imposing a different standard, which is also supposed to be society's standard and not the court's? Would not the court's role be to discover or identify society's standard of decency, not what it should be, but what it is, and how better could society express its standard of decency than through its elected lawmakers? So again, that's just the argument of the people is, again, that these are difficult lines to draw, but they should be drawn by the legislature. And with that, you know, we thank the court for their time and ask that they either affirm the decision of the Court of Appeals or deny leave to appeal.
Thank you. Ms. Rice, you have some time for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'll start by briefly responding to what I understand to be the government's argument on the procedural issue. I think I have two main responses to that position. And I guess the first is that I don't see any basis in the Michigan rules for it. The text doesn't mention holdings or dicta or any Latin. I don't see how it really jives with the purpose of the provision. And I also don't think the state has identified even one judicial decision that looks at the retroactive change in law provision that way, either a Michigan decision or one from another state or federal court applying a similar successive motion standard. It's also difficult for me to imagine that the rules intended courts to undertake what I certainly agree is an interesting and difficult sort of law review type analysis at the threshold filing stage. But I guess second, even assuming the government were right about that, and there was something in the rule that requires courts to parse sort of holdings from dicta in this complicated way, I'm still not sure why that changes the outcome here. The state appears to agree, and Montgomery squarely held that Miller was a retroactive change in law. It contains a new retroactive holding. And the state also doesn't appear to disagree about the meaning of based on. So putting those two points together, I guess, I think even under the state's reading of the provision, we still land in the same place. The motion is based on the retroactive change in law in Miller, even if entitlement to relief isn't automatic under that holding. Beyond that, I guess just a few quick concluding points. I want to be clear here that Mr. Manning is not asking this court to rule that life without parole sentences are always unconstitutional as applied to 18-year-olds. This case is about the much more limited proposition and the one the court considered in Miller about the constitutionality of mandatory life without parole sentences. So the argument is just that that courts need to provide an opportunity to consider mitigating evidence, including the defendant's age, before a sentence like that can be imposed. And I think that's the correct answer under both state and federal law. But because the Michigan Constitution provides greater protection in this context than the federal one, and because this court is the ultimate arbiter of the meaning of the Michigan Constitution, I'd respectfully submit that the court can and should resolve this case on the state constitutional ground. But at the very least, I think, as we discussed earlier, the court should reaffirm that 502G is merely a procedural threshold, sort of exactly what it said in People versus Swain. And that threshold has been satisfied here, and remand for the lower courts to consider the merits in the first instance. Does the court have further questions at this point?
Does anyone have additional questions for Ms. Rice? Seeing none, the case will be submitted. Thank you both.